to church today. It's important that we be here to worship, and it's always good to worship our Savior. And one of the things that God's been doing in our church's life and in my life personally is teaching me and teaching us the importance of seeking the face of God, of prayer. And friends, you know, we may come here today for many different reasons, and we may hope various people are here today to worship with us. And God keeps reminding me time and time again that the most important thing that can happen on a Sunday morning when we come here to church is that we meet with God. If God's not here today, nothing else we do today is going to matter. All right? We can sing and have wonderful music, good teaching, and look at a good passage of Scripture, and that's all important, and we must do that. But really, the power in all of that is if God is meeting with us. That's who we need to touch from Him. We need to meet with Him. And here's what Isaiah 55 tells us in verse 6. It says, "Seek the Lord while He may be found. Call to Him while He is near." Seek the Lord while He may be found. Call to Him while He is near. And all throughout the Bible, we see time and time again the phrase, seek God, or seek the face of the Lord. And so I don't know what's going to happen. This is just what God has laid on my heart. I want us to begin this service just seeking the face of God. Okay? This may be something you're like, well, I don't even know what to do. I'm just going to tell you right now. I'm just inviting us all to bow our heads right now. I don't have any other words to share with you. I don't have any other insights to say other than let's seek the face of God right now. Let's seek the face of God. Let's worship in spirit and truth today. Let's worship with a pure heart. Perhaps right now you need to confess sin to God. Now's the time. God, we invite you here today. I pray you're here with us. Lord, we need you. God, if you're not here and your power is not here through the Holy Spirit, then we're going to leave here without being moved like we should be moved. God, we need you. Perhaps right now there's a major problem in your life, something you're fearful of, something that is scaring you. Perhaps there's an issue going on no one else knows except you, maybe a couple people in your family. The Bible says, seek the Lord while He may be found. Call to Him while He is near. Right now, lift that thing up. Lift that person up. Lift that problem up right now. Let's seek God's face. God, you see our hearts. We humble ourselves before you. We desperately need you today. Lord, we throw away any agenda we have, any negative thought we have today. Lord, this service, this you lead this service, God. You're in charge. We surrender to you. We don't want this to just be another day. We don't want this to just be another Sunday. We want this to be a special day, God. We want this to be a day, God, that you're honored and glorified, that you move in us, that you teach us, that you change us. Lord, what we need today is we need you, we need all of you, we need more of you. God, nothing else matters today to me. I want you. God, today I want to worship you in spirit and in truth, unashamed, humble and bold. God, lead us in this service. We seek you today. Jesus, we love you. Holy Spirit, come, and it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. You guys come with us.
Just stand our feet and join us as we sing this morning.
My soul, it is well.
moment. I want to share with you a couple important announcements. The first announcement I want to share with you is that next Sunday, immediately following the service, we're going to have a youth and kids outing. We're going to have some pizza here, and then right after we eat, we're going to go to Flat Top Mountain, where there's a beautiful pumpkin patch with awesome things to do. There's hay rides, there's a corn maze, there's flower fields where you get your pictures and do all the things that you want to do there. I think I'm speaking to the ladies on that one. All right. I'm sure Chelsea's going to make me get my picture, though. So you can come too, guys. It's going to be all right. We're going to have a good time with that. Now, here's what I want you to know. Everyone's invited. Even if you're not a youth or even if you don't have any kids right now, if you'd like to come, you can come and be a chaperone, okay? So you can come. You can come and be a chaperone and enjoy that time. So we'll leave here after the service, after we eat. We'll go up there. We'll have a good time. We'll be up there for a few hours. And everyone's invited to be. I hope you will. There, it is $10 to get into the pumpkin patch area. And I don't know, they might sell things. So if you want to maybe buy a pumpkin or something like that, you might need some money for that. But it'd be $10 to get in. Now, let me just say this. If for some reason that's just too much money for you, or that's, you know, you've got a bunch of kids and you just think, you know, that don't let money be the reason to keep you from coming. We will have, there'll be a way. God will make a way for you to go and be a part of it. So for whatever reason, you just make sure to come, and we're going to have a good time with that. Also, let me just say, I made this sign-up sheet, all right? Handwritten, old school. I made this. And I'm gonna put it, let's see here. Where can I put it? Over there by the door, there's going to be a table, and I'm going to have this over there. If you're planning on coming, you're hoping you're going to be here, then sign up. Just write like your family's name and how many's going to be with you, okay? Just that'll help us know how much pizza and stuff like that to get. So there's that. Here's another important announcement. Starting next Sunday, we're also going to have a new Sunday school group that is starting. Chuck Baker's going to be teaching that, so this will be Chuck's class. And so that will be happening at 9:30. They're going to begin meeting in the worship center upstairs, so it's set up there for that, and it's going to be a great class. So this is for anybody that's not involved in a Sunday school group. We'd love for you to be involved in one, and this is going to be a great group for you. So if you're not involved, really consider being a part of that. Chuck, would you just stand up real quick for me? Just look. Here's Chuck. Yeah, there he is. There's Chuck. So you can if you're not involved in one, you want to be involved in this, just say, hey, go tell them, say, we're going to show up, or we'd like to maybe come at some point to that. So that'll be a good thing. I think that's all I have in terms of announcements. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward at this time, and we're going to take up the offering this morning. And this is an opportunity for you to engage in worship. Giving is a part of our worship, and we give as an act of worship, and so I want you to engage in that with us, and let's all bow our heads as we ask the Lord to bless the offering today. Father, as we give today, Lord, we give as an act of worship. We thank you, God, for everything you've given us. Lord, even the least of these here in our nation is rich compared to those in other parts of the world. So God, as we consider how you have blessed us, we know that it's all yours anyways. So we want to richly give back to you, trusting you and believing in your goodness, that God, what we give, Lord, you're going to use it to make a difference in this world. So bless this gift. God, bless those that give today. May you be honored, and it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Lamb of God, by His own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been.
This most critical moment in the life and ministry of Jesus. In John chapter 13, we began to look at the last moments, the last hours in the life of Jesus. John's gospel is very powerful in that from chapter 13 through chapter 19, there's a lot of stuff in here, okay? lot of stuff. From 13 through 19, those chapters, all of that content, it's really happening in just in one day in the life of Jesus, one 24-hour span. And Jesus is going to, he's got his disciples, and he's got them together, and they're going to be with him up until he's arrested in the garden. Jesus is pouring out himself to his disciples. There is much for us to get. I didn't want to tell you today that in 30 minutes, if I preach that long today, in 30 minutes time, we can't begin to scratch the surface of the depth of the passage of Scripture we're going to look at. So I encourage you to take notes, and I encourage you to take what we're going to look at and pour over it for the next several weeks, because it's a very important passage of Scripture and a very important lesson that Jesus is teaching us. In John chapter 13, here's what the Word of God says. Now, if you would, we're going to read through verse 11 to begin with. And if you're able, I'm going to ask you to stand in honor of the reading of God's Word. If you don't have a Bible with you, we'll have the words on the screen. It says, "Before the Passover festival, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Now, when it was time for supper, the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Jesus knew that the Father had given everything into his hands, that he had come from God and that he was going back to God. So he got up from supper, laid aside his outer clothing, took a towel, and tied it around himself. Next, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet and to dry them with the towel tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who asked him, 'Lord, are you going to wash my feet?' Jesus answered him, 'What I'm doing, you don't realize now, but afterward, you will understand.' 'You will never wash my feet,' Peter said. Jesus replied, 'If I don't wash you, you have no part with me.' Simon Peter said to him, 'Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head.' 'One who has bathed,' Jesus told him, 'doesn't need to wash anything except his feet, but he is completely clean. You are clean, but not all of you.' For he knew who would betray him. This is why he said, 'Not all of you are clean.'" Father, we ask you would just, in the name of Jesus and through the Holy Spirit, that you would impact our lives today with your word. That not only would we hear it and understand it, but God, we would receive your word and apply it to our lives, that we would leave here differently. God, do your work, the only work that you can do. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Here's what I want to talk to you today about: serving like Jesus. Serving like Jesus. We need to be a people that serves the way Jesus served. That serves like Jesus serves. It's Passover, and Jesus has his disciples in an upper room. And after this, what we'll see next week most likely, they're going to have the first Lord's Supper together. And so he gets them together, and they're going to do this. In fact, actually, it's within this foot washing that they're going to have this supper together. And so here they are. They're in this upper room with Jesus. And the Bible tells us that what Jesus does next is beyond almost belief. In the first century there, what was common was that when you would go into someone's home, that you would have your feet washed. Sometimes you would wash your own feet, but lots of times the owner of a home would make a way to have someone there to wash the feet of the guests that have come into that home. Now, you have to remember, in Palestine in the first century, it's not like walking around our streets today. They weren't paved. They were muddy. They were dusty. They were dirty. Also, in the first century, they weren't wearing Adidas and Nike and Reebok and every other shoe that whatever it is you wear. You wear some type of shoe in here, okay? Also, they weren't wearing socks. I hope you wear socks. If you don't wear socks, your feet stink. If you smell anything in here today, somebody's not wearing socks. Their feet are stinking. All right? So, here they are, first century. It's hot in Palestine. They're walking around leather sandals. I was on a mission trip once with someone that didn't wear socks and wore leather sandals. I'm glad they weren't in my room. Phew. All right, stinky. So here they were, walking around, dusty, dirty, nasty. And so when they would go into a house, there would be a basin of water, and there would be a servant, or there would be someone there that would have that task of washing the feet of the guest as they were in the home. And what the Bible tells us is that the disciples are with Jesus in this upper room, and they're having the Lord's Supper together. Now, here's what you need to understand what it looks like. They weren't sitting at a dining room table like we sit at. In fact, there weren't even chairs. Most likely what they were doing, what they would lay on their side, and they might have their hand up like this on one side and an elbow. They would have their feet kind of coming out this way. They had climbed in a type of circle with the table or the setting there on the floor with the food around them. And so here they would be lying down with their feet out, and they would be eating. Now, at this point, no one has washed anybody's feet. At this moment, you would think what would take place is that Peter or James or John or one of the other disciples would say, "Hey, this is a good opportunity. I need to wash Jesus' feet." In fact, Mary's already given them that example as she anointed the feet of Jesus. We saw that just a couple weeks ago. Here they are. Nobody has their feet washed. They're reclining there on the ground. And what happens next makes our mouth fall open. Jesus stands up from his space. And it says he takes off his outer garment. I don't have my coat on today because when I was walking in, I spilled my drink on the sleeve. And it wasn't ready yet for me to wear. So I left it up in my office. That was the outer garment, would be a big something that he would wear over the rest of his clothes. So he took his outer garment off. He still had clothes on. But he took that outer garment off. And the Bible says that next what Jesus did was he got the water basin and he had it full of water. And he took a towel. He wrapped a towel around himself. And what happens next is Jesus gets on his knees like this, and he goes around to his disciples with that towel, with the water, and he begins taking those dirty feet, and with his hands and with that towel, he begins to massage, he begins to clean and wash the feet of his disciples. He goes from one disciple to the next. There's 12 disciples there that day, and he's going around and he's washing everyone's feet. He's cleaning them off. And he comes to Simon Peter, and Simon says, "Lord, you're not going to wash my feet." Jesus says, "Oh, yes, I am." He says, "If I don't wash your feet, then you have no part in me." And Simon says, "Oh, then you need to wash my whole body, Jesus." Jesus says, "You've already been washed clean." Jesus is talking spiritually here. He's saying, "You already have trusted in me. You've already have a relationship with me." He says, "You don't need to have your whole body washed, but you do need to have your feet washed because even though you've trusted in me, you will still have sin in your life. And when you sin, you need to confess that sin to me, and you need to allow me to scrub that off of you." But here's what we see with Jesus. We see Jesus setting an example of what it means to serve. And today I want us to see that we should serve like Jesus serves. The first thing I want you to notice is that Jesus served selflessly. We should serve selflessly. If we're going to be servants the way Jesus serves. Jesus, in fact, said, I didn't come to be served, but I came to serve. Here we're going to see in a moment, he says, a servant is not greater than his master. Friends, Jesus is our Lord. Jesus is our master. Let me ask you, are you living as if you are greater than your master? Are you living today as if you are greater than Jesus himself? Jesus said, I came to serve, and Jesus got down on his hands and knees and washed those dirty feet. A role that in the first century only really some of the lowliest people would fulfill that role. He served selflessly. Look at it with me here, verse 1. Before the Passover festival, Jesus knew that his hour had come. I want you to see some things that Jesus knew. First, we see it says he knew his hour had come. Look down at verse 3. Verse 3 says, Jesus knew that the Father had given everything into his hands and that he had come from God. And that he was going back to God. Three things that Jesus knew and that the Bible shares with us. Number one, Jesus knew his hour had come. We had already talked about that last week. The hour of the glory of God. The hour of the death. The hour of the crucifixion. This is Jesus' moment. This is Jesus' hour. This is Jesus' time. This is the time when Jesus is to be worshipped. Jesus is to be celebrated. Okay? And I want you to think about how in our lives we have so many moments where what we're tempted to say is, this is my moment. Right? The ladies in the room, and it is true. It's true. It's wedding day. This is my day. Guys, it's your retirement day. This is my day. Kids, your birthday. This is my day. Okay. We live, hear me now, we live in a self-centered age. We don't live in an age of selflessness. We live in an age of selfishness. It's always about me. My day. My hour. My moment. My thing. This is, Jesus says, and he knows, this is my hour. And this would be the hour that in that moment he would get on his knees. In that humble servant's role and wash his disciples' feet. See, if you're going to serve, and if we're going to serve, and we should serve like Jesus, we must serve selflessly. But I want you to notice there in verse 3, what else did Jesus know? He knew that the Father had given everything into his hands. This is speaking of his authority, church. Jesus has all authority. Jesus has all power. Jesus has all control. Jesus has all rule. Jesus can do whatever Jesus wants to do. Jesus can look into the rocks and he can say, worship me and sing praises. And the rocks are going to all of a sudden start, I don't know if they're going to have a mouth or what all of a sudden, but they're going to start singing the praises of Jesus. If he says it, it's going to happen. We saw it in chapter 11. He said, Lazarus, come forth. A dead man came out of the grave and he came walking. The Father has placed all things in his hands. Guess what? Jesus knows it. No one is greater than Jesus. Jesus is the greatest. He is high and he is lifted up. He has all authority, all rule. All things are underneath him. The Bible says, heaven is my throne room. The earth is my footstool. That's Jesus we're talking about today. But yet, here Jesus is. And what does Jesus do? All things have been given into his hands. He is high and above all people and all things. But yet, the one that is most high and holy and lifted up, he gets down on his knees with these wicked sinners that he has called his disciples. And he takes his hand and he takes the water and he takes the towel and begins to wash his disciples' feet. selfless, the one who had all right and has all right, has all authority, has all power, has all control, says, I get down on my knees to serve the least of these here. Friend, the disciples, they're below and beneath Jesus. But Jesus got beneath them for a moment to wash their feet. But in getting beneath Jesus, he shows just how much high and higher he truly is. Do you see what else it says? Not only did he know the Father had given everything into his hands, but that he had come from God and that he is going back to God. Listen, this speaks to the deity of Jesus. This speaks to the fact of who Jesus is. He is the eternal Son of God. Before you and I ever existed, here the Son of God is. But before time existed, here the Son of God is. When it came time to create the world, the Father created the world through the Son who existed before time ever existed. Here Jesus is. He is the eternal Son of God. He has come from the Father. He has come from heaven, from glory, down to this wicked earth. He has come here and he knows he is about to go back there, back to his glory. So he knows who he is. He knows his right and his authority. And he knows that this is his moment and his hour. But yet he is selfless in his service. He's selfless in his service. When you think about selflessness and service, I want you to consider that we live in the age of self-centeredness. I mean, just think about it. All the popular books are what? Self-help books. In fact, I'd say many of you in here have read self-help books. Most of us in here are on some form of social media. And one of the big things with social media is selfies. That's where the selfie, selfies came from. That's where they got popular. You take selfies. I mean, just think about what a selfie is for a moment. And think about, why do we take selfies and put them on social media? Hey, look at me. I mean, that's what it is. Look at me. Look what I've done. Look where I am. I'm over at this cool place. Look at me. I'm not saying don't take selfies or anything like that, okay? I'm just telling you, though. Let's consider the age we live in. What is it? It's the age that's all about me. Look at me. I want to prop myself up, even if it means I'm going to put these other people down. Because it's all about me. I remember being on a mission trip to Jamaica. There were over 100 missionaries. It was a humongous operation. And for breakfast and dinner, there was a Jamaican family that had a house up on a hill. And they had some kind of some property. And so they had these big tents, kind of like revival tents, if you will, set up all on this property. And there were family members of this household there in Jamaica that they would cook all of the food to feed like 125 people for breakfast and lunch for the entire week. And it was an awesome place, like, because up on top of this hill, you could look out, you could see the ocean, the coastline. It was really neat. And of course, here we are as missionaries, and we're there. We're serving, we're preaching, we're teaching, we're going to hospitals and jails, and we're doing all these things and having sports clinics and like VBS-style outreach with kids. And man, we're really working hard. And when you went up here to the house to eat in the morning and at dinner time, it was almost like a time to just sit back and relax and catch yourself. But I'll never forget the lesson I was taught one of the days there. In fact, it was, I believe, the first day we were there. So you can imagine all the dirty dishes, all the things that come. And what? Those dishes are going to go through that little tiny washroom that's connected to that house. Probably the most senior and respected pastor missionary that was there that day, that pretty much to a man, every single person on that trip would have looked to that person and said, if we need help or we have a question, that's who we're going to go ask. If we need somebody to pray for us, that's who we're going to go to. I mean, the most senior and respected person on that mission trip. And I happened to be sitting by him that day, and he said, come with me. We're going to go into the kitchen. Before everybody else got finished eating, and this man got me and took me into the kitchen. And there, we got a towel and got ready. And the lady, the Jamaican ladies that were there ready to do the cleaning, we said, y'all go ahead and go eat and do what you want to do, because we'll be doing the cleaning today. And that person taught me what it meant to be selfless in your service. And there, he showed me how we would wash and clean every dish as it came in that day. As we had gone to Jamaica to be missionaries for the week. See, that's what selfless service looks like. It'd be easy in that situation to say, we'll let somebody else do this right now. But selfless service says, I'll do the thing that others really don't want to do. I'll do the thing that I can probably get away with not doing and letting somebody else do it today. But yet Jesus gives us this wonderful example of washing his disciples' feet. I want you to notice something else, though. I want you to just look at verse 10 and 11 with me. In verse 10 and 11, it says, one who has bathed, Jesus told him, doesn't need to wash anything except his feet. But he is completely clean. You are clean, he says, but not all of you. For he knew in verse 11, for he knew who would betray him. This is why he said, not all of you are clean. Now, we read this earlier, prior to this. Jesus knows who's going to betray him. And who is it? It's Judas Iscariot. Did you know that day when they were gathered around that meal and they were lying there and Jesus went around and he washed his disciples' feet? You know who one of those 12 disciples were that Jesus washed his feet? It was Judas Iscariot. And here Judas Iscariot is, and it's literally moments, if not, it's hours, if not moments away from Judas Iscariot going to the authorities. He's already planned it. He's already lined up the betrayal. He's already spoken with the authorities. And he's going to go to the authorities and say, I know where Jesus is. Look, now's the time. Go get him and arrest Jesus. Jesus already knows all of these things. And here Judas Iscariot is, and I want you to think about this for a moment. Jesus, knowing that one of the people that he's going to serve, one of the people that he selflessly serves, that he gets on his feet, he gets dirty with, his hands get dirty, he cleans those nasty feet of Judas Iscariot, he knows this is one that's going to betray him. So if Jesus teaches us first that we're to serve selflessly, second, he teaches us that we're to serve sacrificially. We're to serve sacrificially. One of the great temptations in serving is that we serve to get something in return. That's a great temptation in serving. That I'm going to serve or I'm going to do something, and really in my heart, I'm hoping I'm going to get something in return for it. That it's going to come back to me some way or somehow. Listen, that might sound good in some entrepreneurial book. That might sound good in running a company and a business. You know, that might sound good in some self-help book. Okay, whatever. Jesus shows us that when we serve, we're to do it sacrificially, not that we think we're going to get something out of it, but simply to give. See, Jesus was serving not to get. What was Jesus serving? He was serving to give. He was giving himself. He was giving his love. He was giving his service. You say, well, how do you know he wasn't trying to get something? I'll tell you how I know. In fact, he knows he's going to get something all right. He knows he's going to get something. He knows the thing he's going to get is a betrayer. Now, how hard is it for you to serve when you consider that the person you're serving, they're going to stab you in the back? The person you're serving is not going to help you in your time of need. I've encountered it so many times as a pastor. Loving people, serving people. You know, people start visiting the church, and man, you think, and they keep coming, and you start to love on them and to serve them, and you do all these things with them, and you're thinking, this is going to help. And sometimes as a pastor, you do those things thinking you're going to get them, and it's going to help to get them so that they'll give you something, meaning they'll give you themselves within the fellowship. You know how many times that I've done that, and I've sacrificed, and I've given my time, my family's time? I could have been with my family, but I was over there. You know how many times I've done that to then later them say, there's just a better church for us down the road. See, God really convicted my heart as I was studying this. He said, listen, you don't serve to get something. You serve to give something. He said, if Jesus served the one that he knew would betray him, that would stab him in the back, that would turn him into the authorities, that would bring them and give him that holy kiss on the cheek and say, here he is, boys, take him. Jesus, knowing that it's just moments away, yet Jesus still served. See, if we're going to serve like Jesus, we must serve sacrificially. Not serving to get something, but serving to give. Period. Say, man, that's hard. It is hard. It is hard. But it's good. You say, man, that's hard. It's okay. It is hard. But you know what? God will bless it. God will honor it. You say, that's really, really hard. It is hard. But you know what God has called us to do? He's called us to serve him and leave the rest up to him. That's it. Leave the rest up to him. We see if we're going to serve like Jesus, we need to serve selflessly and we need to serve sacrificially. Now, I want us to look in verse 12, and we're going to finish this thing out. What time is it, somebody? I got 2 minutes. We're going to go a couple minutes over, okay? Hang with me. Here we go. When Jesus had washed their feet and put on his outer clothing, he reclined again and said to them, do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are speaking rightly, since that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. So he explains what he is doing, right? He's explained it. It's as clear as day. He says, if I've done this, if I've set this example, you're to do the same thing. And what Jesus is really teaching is not that we need to be washing one another's feet literally all the time here, but he's showing us service. This was a major act of service that he gave to his disciples. He's saying, you've seen how I've served selflessly. I've served sacrificially. I command you, now you do it to one another as well. Look at this. He says, truly, truly, I tell you, a servant is not greater than his master. Once again, are we living as if we're greater than Jesus? Are we saying, those things are beneath me? That role's beneath me. That act of service, that's beneath my dignity. That's beneath who I am. Don't you know what I've done before? I've elevated beyond all of that. Jesus says, you're not greater than your master. And if Jesus, your master, lowered himself to this point, you too can lower yourself to this point. In fact, I want you to look at this with me. Philippians chapter 2, starting in verse 3. He's got it on the screen. Philippians 2, starting in verse 3, Drew. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility consider others more important than yourselves. Everyone should look not to his own interest, but rather to the interest of others. Now listen to this, verse 5. Adopt the same attitude or the mind of Christ Jesus, who existing in the form of God, did not consider equality with God a thing to be grasped or a thing to be held on to, a thing to be exploited. Instead, he emptied himself. Jesus literally emptied himself of his glory. He left the throne room of heaven, and he became, by assuming the form of a servant, of a man, of a servant, taking on the likeness of humanity. God, eternal God, the Son of God, he eternally has now taken on the flesh of man, which he has created. And now here he is, and he has become a man. And it says in verse 8, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death. Not just any death, but it says even death of the cross. Death of the cross was the cruelest death in the history of civilization. Jesus humbled himself to leave glory to come to this earth. He humbled himself to become a man born of the Virgin Mary. He humbled himself to serve sinful men and women as he walked the face of this earth in his ministry. He humbled himself that the eternal God, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, he would die, literally, death. But not just any death, but death on a cross, naked, mocked, blasphemed against, spit upon, cursed, nails through his wrist, nails through his feet, hanging before the people, hanging before two criminals, and there he is, bleeding and dying because he's the only way, and his blood's the only way for you to be saved. Jesus, let's go back, chapter 13. Jesus says, a servant is not greater than his master. Friends, Jesus is our master. Jesus is our Lord. He says, you are not greater than me. A servant is not greater than his master. A messenger is not greater than the one who sent him. He says, now look, this is where we're closing right here. We're closing. Give me 3 minutes, and we'll make it quick. We're closing. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Here's the third point. It was hard to tie in, but it's sanctifying. Sanctifying. So in three S's, selfless, sacrificial, sanctifying. Okay? What is sanctification? What is being sanctified? It is God's work of the Holy Spirit in your life, making you more and more like Jesus. It's the Holy Spirit working in your life to make you more like Jesus. If, Jesus says, if you know these things and do them, you will be blessed. You see, we don't serve to get, but when you serve selflessly, when you serve sacrificially with the right heart, God does give you something. He gives you a blessing. Say, yes, a blessing. That's what I've been looking for. I've been waiting for this, a blessing. Friends, oftentimes, here's what we think about blessing. We think health and wealth. We think fame and treasure. Fame and fortune. That's what we think about oftentimes when we think about blessing, but that's, God's really not concerned with that. Does God bless us in that way? Sometimes he does bless us in that way. Sometimes he does bless us with fortune or fame or health. Sometimes he does. But you need to realize, why does he do that sometimes? He does it for the same reasons as I'm about to share with you. See, the reason he would give you those things and bless you with those things is to give you the opportunity to be sanctified and become more like Jesus. If he has given you fame, he has given it to you for you to use for his glory. He's given it to you not for yourself, but for you to give away. If he's given you fortune, he's not giving you fortune so that you feel good about yourself, that you've got security and all those kinds of things. He's given you fortune to give you an opportunity to be sanctified by giving it away. Because what God's desire for you is for you to be blessed in the greatest blessing that we can experience on this earth after having received Jesus Christ for salvation, and that is to being blessed by being made more like Jesus, our Savior. See, that's what the true blessing is. He says, if you will serve selflessly, and if you will serve sacrificially, you know these things, but you got to do more than just know them. See, you can know them after this message today, but you got to do them. And he says, if you know them and you do them, then you will be blessed. The Holy Spirit will take your life and he will make you more and more like Jesus through your serving like him. Some areas that you could serve. Let me just give you this. Say, where can I serve? Here's where you can serve. Number one, you can serve in your marriage. You can serve in your marriage. If you want a good marriage, you want a successful marriage, you want a God-honoring marriage, you want a marriage that lasts, serve in your marriage. Serve the way Jesus serves. Serve selflessly. Serve sacrificially. If a husband and wife both serve that way towards one another, it will be one of the most glorious marriages the earth will see. Serve. Serve one another, just as Jesus says. Serve selflessly. Serve sacrificially. Guys, serve your wife. Do the dishes. Vacuum a room. Put gas in her car. Wash the car. Whatever she needs, serve her. Well, she's supposed to submit to me. I don't have time to go to Ephesians right now and break it down for you. Jesus says, husband, love your wife as I have loved the church. And how did Jesus love the church? He not only got down on his knees and washed his disciples' feet, but he went to the cross and he died for her. Serve your wife. Well, she doesn't do anything for me. That doesn't matter. Serve your wife selflessly, sacrificially. Ladies, serve your husband. Say, well, he doesn't do anything. He doesn't serve like you just said, preacher. Doesn't matter. Serve him selflessly, sacrificially. Do it unto the Lord. You will be blessed. You'll be honored. Family, do it in your family. Serve in your family. Serve your parents. Serve your grandparents. Serve your siblings. Serve, just serve in your family. Serve in the church. There's another area you can serve. Serve in the church. You see a need, do it. You see trash, pick it up. Say the janitor's supposed to, yeah, janitor is supposed to do that, but you can do it. If the janitor didn't do it, pick it up, throw it away. Serve, do something. Jesus says, a servant is not greater than his master. Selfless, sacrificial, to be made more like Jesus. Father, make us more like Jesus. Jesus, thank you for this example you've given us. Oh, how humbling it is. Jesus, may we not only know these things, but may we do them. Change our hearts to be hearts of humility, that we would get on our knees to serve anyone that needs to be served. Lord, if there's someone here today that needs to make a decision, Holy Spirit, that you're drawing them in a way supernaturally to salvation, to church fellowship, to baptism, then God, lead them at this time of response. And it's in Jesus' name I pray, amen. If you would please stand to your feet. We're going to have a time to respond. This is an opportunity for you to come. Please come as we all sing.
I have decided.
You just need to come pray. The altar's open. Come pray.
To follow Jesus.
If you'd like to become a part of our church family, join our fellowship, come forward and tell me.
To follow Jesus.
You want to humble yourself?
yourself to the point of baptism, come forward and say, I need to humble myself and be baptized. Possibly to ask Jesus as your Savior. Whatever it is, please come.
To follow Jesus, no turning back.
It has been. Lord, we desire this every time we gather like this to meet with you. And Lord, I pray that you would empower us through the Holy Spirit to walk with you every day. And as we walk with you, that we would serve Jesus as you serve. Lord, if you are still dealing with and speaking into someone's heart today, if they need to speak with me, then I just pray, God, you give them the courage to find me afterwards and just let me know what it is that you're doing in their life. We love you today, and it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you for being here today. We're dismissed.